Good evening, everyone. Thank you. I know some folks are still getting settled, and so we can start with the students. I had a couple of announcements, but since I am podiumless, they will be sent out over B-Space today. You are saved. Although I will make the announcement that if we catch anybody one more time on Facebook, on their computers, instead of actually taking notes for this course, I will come after you. I just want to let you know. So what we just saw on the screen was Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, 1939. And there's an interesting question raised there, right? Mr. Smith is a guy that just wanted to do the right thing in politics. So students, please take out your clickers, because I have a question for you. In terms of doing right in politics, is that possible? Do you believe in the political process? Press A if you do, and press B if you don't. Especially curious about this, what do young folks in college think nowadays? What have we got, Alex? 54% say yes. Yes, go ahead. Give that a round of applause. Because really, everything is political, right? Family is political. Our government is just a type of governance. And what we're going to be talking about today is really, what does governance look like? Because governance involves the distribution of resources. It involves making sure that everyone has access to the basic things they need. And Alice Waters, with the Edible Schoolyard, says that every child needs to have access not only to really healthy food, but they need access to experiential education that actually allows a child to learn, something called edible education. Now, when I was in school, I can definitely tell you that I learned a lot better in science class in the fourth grade when my teacher could actually show through the rabbits in the classroom or through my little plant that I now had to grow. I still remember that, Ms. Schumann, fourth grade. Hi, Ms. Schumann, if you're watching. But that was one of my favorite things about being in school. So how do we do that? How do we create equity across educational lines? How do we make sure that children are fed all day? How do we make sure that you keep learning even as an adult? Mr. Smith Goes to Washington says that it's not optional. Do not be limited by what you think the system can do. The system should respond to your dreams and your visions. So, Alice Waters today and Robert Reich are going to be in a conversation about how you do that. How you push a system so that things are not optional. And to introduce a couple of my heroes. Robert Reich is the Chancellor Professor of Public Policy here at UC Berkeley. He served in three national administrations, most recently as Secretary of Labor under Clinton, and he's the author of 13 books, the most recent being Aftershock. Alice Waters is a pioneer of the fresh, local, seasonal thing that many people my age can't even remember before, but there was a before, and Alice Waters was a pioneer. 40 years. In 1996, that saw the creation of the Edible Schoolyard at Martin Luther King School, right on the border of Oakland and Berkeley. And now the Edible Schoolyard Project is something that encourages edible schoolyards all over the place to exist so that children can have equitable education everywhere. And Alice is the author of 8 books, including The Art of Simple Food, which is actually one of my favorites. So please put your hands together and welcome Robert Reich and Alice Waters.
Pleased to be here tonight, and I'm particularly pleased because Michael Pollan and Nikki Henderson agreed to do this course at the university, Edible Education 101. And I've been kind of dreaming about this forever, that somebody would take it seriously enough to make it a accredited course at the university. And I just wanted to make it as real as possible for you tonight. I wish I could feed you this idea. I wish I could feed you all. I just brought some things for you to look at, sadly, and to smell and to see. But I wanted particularly to tell you that every person who has come to speak to you is somebody that I really admire. They're mentors of mine, and they've educated me. And I feel so lucky to have had that and have had the persuasion to bring a lot of them here to talk to you. It's really something extraordinary to have all of these different points of view. Now, I've heard Eric Schlosser speak many, many times. I thought when his book came out that it was kind of the fuel for our fire. But last week, when he spoke, I learned something new that I've incorporated into the whole idea of edible education. And that is that the farm workers need to be brought into the forefront. I always assumed when I talk about farmers and how precious they are, that the farm workers are, of course, included in that. But I'm going to make it explicit when I talk about it. Explicit. And it was because of that class. But I wanted to have Bob Reich come for a lot of reasons. One, of course, because he is an extraordinary teacher. And I remember when I taught Montessori school to 3 and 6 year olds, that I was so intimidated by them. They knew so much more. They asked me so much from me that I had to leave teaching. 6 year olds. So I just didn't. I just love having Bob here to talk when I can't. And also because he has been a confidant of presidents. I like that. That sort of intimacy of communication. And thirdly, because he speaks so honestly and so full of integrity that his reflection on edible education is really, really important to me. So I'm hoping he can answer all the questions that I can answer. So we're going to have this little conversation. And you begin, Bob.
Well, let me just thank Alice and Nikki and others for putting this together. Alice and I met a couple of times to try to decide how we would go about talking about all of this. Alice said, well, do you want to come over for lunch to Chez Panisse? And I said, yes. And we had two wonderful lunches, and we decided that we would have a conversation, that a conversation asking Alice questions. I have huge numbers of questions to ask Alice, and she asking me questions about politics and the economy and the sociology of all of this. And by the way, for those of you who have taken my courses, you know that I believe that these compartments called economics and politics and sociology are artificially created, that actually there are enormous connections between these fields, and probably, I will learn tonight, between politics, economics, sociology, and food. Before we begin, one other final point. Alice introduced me to the concept of edible education. When I first heard it, Alice, I didn't know exactly what it was. I mean, I, I, I have to confess to you, I thought maybe it was about ingesting the alphabet, or maybe about devouring the times tables. It would seem to me two words that didn't normally go together. But here's what I did know about you, and maybe you can elucidate as we get going. Somebody had told me that you, in fact, I'd heard it from several people, you were the only 60s revolutionary who succeeded. Maybe I would love to know a little bit more, not only about how you succeeded, because that would take presumably a lot of time, but what your vision was and why you began thinking as you did 40 years ago or 43 or 40 years ago. What was your revolutionary vision? Where did it come from?
Well, I guess when people press me on that and say, where did it really come from? How did you become so passionate about food? I've gone way back into my childhood and ended up at my parents' victory garden during World War II. They had a vegetable garden in the back of the house, and I used to go out there when I was 2 years old, I'm told, and eat the warm strawberries out of the garden. And people probably know, because I wrote it in a book, that I won a contest for being dressed as the queen of the garden when I was about 4 years old. But my mother wasn't a good cook. And I was a very picky eater as a kid, really picky eater. I liked sort of green beans and when my dad cooked a steak out there on the barbecue. But that was about it. My mother was interested in my health, and we had brown bread, and I always wanted to trade my sandwiches at school. I was very skinny and resistant, I guess you would say. And it wasn't until I came to Berkeley in 1964, and I was kind of front and center on the free speech movement. Not actually arrested, but on the fringe, around the edge. And I listened to this person, Mario Savio, speak, and I was really moved by him. He was so idealistic, and he really believed we could stop the war and we could live together in this beautiful, harmonious way. And I just absorbed all of that. But then I went to France. Now, for somebody who's never eaten before, it was kind of a revelation to me. I just woke up when I tasted that baguette and that apricot jam. I never had anything like that before. And it was a time in France when you had to go to the farmer's market twice a day so that you could get just what was being brought in fresh. And I wasn't thinking about that. I wasn't thinking about seasonality. I wasn't thinking about aliveness of food. I wasn't thinking about sustainability. I had no idea about anything except my being drawn to this food and liking it a whole lot, going back again the next day and standing in line and waiting to have those little tiny strawberries. And so when I came back from France, I wanted to eat like that. I wanted to live like that. And I started cooking. And I invited my friends over to dinner. And this was in college. And then after college, I started teaching Montessori school. Just to get a job, a friend said I could be an intern. And I went. And that again, it just kind of opened my mind she believed that the information comes into your mind through your senses. So if you educate your senses, your sense of touch, smell, taste, your visual sense of hearing, that you're able to bring the most beautiful information in. And if you're closed down in those ways, then it doesn't happen. And I really believe that. And it's kind of what I tried to stimulate a little bit tonight with the fire out in front. I wanted you to smell it. I would have brought the fire in here, except I think the fire alarms would have caught. That's happened before. We've caused those fire alarms to go off. But I wanted you to see something on the screen. And that sort of all got me thinking. And I suppose really the turning point, aside from the fact that I had, when I started Chez Panisse, I left, as I told you, I was not a very patient teacher. And I thought, you know, I just want to eat good food and hang out with my friends and talk about politics and, you know, how we're going to change the world. And maybe I could make a little money if I opened up a restaurant and they all had to come there to eat. And that's what I did. That's what I did. I opened Chez Panisse on $10,000 in 1971 in an old house, so it would feel like you were coming to somebody's house for dinner.
You know, I had a very ambivalent relationship with food, I have to confess, because when I was three, I was expelled from preschool.
No.
and it all was because of the meal that was served, which was almost inedible. But I was so, I didn't want to hurt this preschool teacher's feelings. And so she said, "Why haven't you eaten it?" And I said, "Well, it was delicious." And she expelled me for excessive sarcasm. I was three, Alice. And then I was told by relatives and friends, I was very finicky, I didn't eat very much, and they said, if you don't eat, you're going to be very short. but I went to France as well, and discovered taste buds I did not know existed. I can understand what happened. But what about edible education, if we can shift specifically to that? Because you at some point along the line, your Montessori background, and given your enthusiasm with regard to Chez Panisse, your understanding of French cuisine, your sense and understanding of how all of the senses affect education and one's capacity to absorb life. At some point, the notion of edible education kind of clicked into place for you.
And I think it probably was about around the time of the 25th birthday of the restaurant. And people were asking me, you know, questions about how we existed for such a long period of time and what was I planning on doing next. And I had just had a child, and I was worried about her future, and I was just in that place where I was kind of thinking again about my time of teaching and in public schools, and it turned out that I was interviewed as saying that something about public education in Berkeley, something about how shameful it was that there were public schools that looked like abandoned construction sites, and with graffiti all over the walls and the shrubs ripped up, and the I used to walk by King's School, drive by it on my way to the restaurant, and it really was something that was provoking me. And I said to a newspaper guy, told him that, and the principal of the school called me up. And he said, could you come down? I want to talk to you. I want to talk to you about beautifying our school. So I went into his office, and he said he'd like me to plant a garden. He heard that I was interested in gardening. Could I plant it on the front of the school? And so we took a walk around, and then all of a sudden it clicked for me. I said, you know, I don't want to do it just to garden on the school. I don't want to, I want to do the whole thing. I believe in public education. I want to touch every child. And all of a sudden it was as if this whole vision of edible education sort of became whole. That I wanted it in the public school in the way at part of the core curriculum. I wanted to plant a garden. I wanted to incorporate the cafeteria into academia. I didn't want it as a catering off on the side. I wanted it to be actually a class that kids could participate in, and all of my Montessori training flooded in. It needed to be an interactive education, and kids could begin in kindergarten, and they should all be fed for free, and they would grow up with a whole different set of values. And it just sort of came to me whole like that. And I told the principal, and he said, I'll give you a call back. And I thought, okay, it's over. And then he called me back 6 months later, and he said, I think we're ready to do it. And he said, but let's just start with the garden. Don't tell anybody about feeding all the kids for free. I'm in. And this was Neil Smith, beautiful Neil Smith. He said, I'm in, but don't tell anybody yet, because I think it might frighten them. And we're not sure where the money's coming from. And so let's just begin with the garden.
And if so I could ask you, just interrupt.
Yes.
You said he was afraid that if the word got out that that you were feeding kids for free, that might be a problem. But was there anything else he was afraid of? Was he afraid of the bureaucracy? Was he afraid of how teachers would react? I mean, a lot of this has to be, people have got to be educated into different ways of doing things.
He was afraid of all of that. And so he started what he called a revolutionary committee at King's School. And he invited different parents that he thought would be excited about this idea and different teachers to become part of it. And I, of course, was ready to plant the garden, grab everybody we knew and just go down to King's School and plant it, you know, clear the piece of land that was next, the vacant lot that was part of the school grounds. And Anil said, just let's take our time. Let's take our time. And so I invited the math classes, just like I invited you over to have lunch. And it was very, I told them to come over and have their meetings at Chez Panisse, and they loved that. They loved coming to the restaurant. And two of the math and science teachers became very enthusiastic. And they were the two who first kind of brought their classes in to the idea of the garden and the building of the garden. And that's how it began, and one by one. And then another group of teachers came. And then I invited the principal and all the principals of the schools in Berkeley to come and have lunch. And our very first event that we had at the school was one where we invited Berkeley Horticulture to bring all of their citrus trees over and put them on the lawn of the school, and we made like an oasis right in front of the building. And the kids made different kinds of sherbet out of all the different citrus. And we asked every kid in the school. Now, these are 6th, 7th, and 8th graders, mind you. And there are 1,000 of them. And they speak 22 different languages in that school at home. So it's a real cross-section of kids. And they're a little hard to, you know how teenagers are. I mean, the 6th graders are divine. The 7th graders get a little harder. And I asked them to come after school and taste these sherbets and decide what fruit that they were made out of. And the person who guessed them all would win the prize of a tart from Chez Panisse. And so we thought we'd get about 100 kids. And we got about 500 kids who wanted to do that. And then it began. That kind of bringing them in to a new relationship to food through pleasure. And as Carla Bottrini talked about that in the first class, that it's so important that we use that principle, that we really, we're not telling kids what they can't eat. We're just bringing them into that garden, into the beauty of nature. We're bringing them around the table, and we're showing them how much we care about them. And that's what's gone on at King. We built the garden classroom and the kitchen classroom.
And so does the school, or for that matter, Cambridge, the Berkeley schools, do they have an actual curriculum already set up in math and in science and maybe in languages that's the edible curriculum?
Well, they do. It's really all come together in a way. I mean, there were many, I wouldn't say many, but a number of teachers that have been doing various experiments in their classrooms before we ever arrived, of bringing, just a portable frying pan into the kitchen and doing little experiments in the science class around food. But once we had built the garden, once we really had that sort of classroom in place, and we had a staff that could help to work with the teacher of the particular subject to sort of develop the way the class would work, it gained a lot of momentum. Instead of having just one teacher there with 35 kids, you have that teacher with a very skilled gardener in the garden classroom, maybe an AmeriCorps, maybe a volunteer who's come in to help. And the same happened in the kitchen classroom. And even the drama classes would come in and they do improvisational cooking. Well, this has been going on for 15 years now. And it's really amazing how many people have come to see this experiment. We have about 1,000 visitors a year. We had the Prince of Wales come. We had the Surgeon General come. We've had all of our senators come from the state. We've had teachers, we've had students from colleges to come and do projects. We've set up an academy at the school in the summer, and people come from around the world and learn these principles and learn these ideas of teaching.
Alice, presumably the curriculum is designed, as you describe it. The curriculum is designed not only to help students learn the subject matter more easily through not just one sense, but a variety of senses, that is, mm-hmm. given smell and touch and taste, but, and the theory is that, and you, I gather this, you got this from your own experience with Montessori education, the theory is that a multiple avenues to learning will help students learn their mathematics, their science, their English, their everything else. But presumably there's another curriculum here as well, and that is you're helping students to learn about good eating. You're giving them the habits of eating well. You're explaining to them the ecological system of how food fits into geography, the economy, and society. Is that not, am I reading too much into this?
No, you're not reading even enough into it. Because I really think, in a way, that it is going to solve all the problems of the world. You know, I really think it's something very, very basic that's been going on since civilization began, that people gather food that is grown close by. They sell it in the marketplaces. They prepare it together with families and friends, and then they come and sit around the table and they eat it together. They celebrate the rituals of life. They consider food as something that's precious. They connect it to the seasons. They enjoy the ripeness of a particular, you know, a beautiful pomegranate when it's here, the beauty of this, they give thanks. I mean, this is something that I think we're all longing for. We've been kind of indoctrinated for the last 50 years by, maybe even more than that, by Fast Food Nation. And they have been thorough in their indoctrination. They want us to know that food should be fast, cheap, and easy. In fact, I think of that little joke that was on a bumper sticker. I can't remember the joke. I'm not so good at jokes. I can't remember the joke, but I'll remember it. But if you are what you eat, then I'm fast, cheap, and easy. But thank you. But this is, it's, I think we can laugh at that, but it's not funny. It's really, it's not funny because it's so serious. Because we are what we eat, and we digest those values. So if you're out there grazing with fast food, you're digesting the values of uniformity. The everything should be the same, no matter where you live on the planet. There are no seasons. There's a very limited number of things that we should be eating that are good for us. The people who grow the food are of no importance. The people who prepare it in the kitchen are paid the least amount of money. That you should be able to eat that food 24/7. And that, you know, it's okay to waste. There's always more where that came from. Now, it would be one thing if it just that kind of thinking just applied to food. But it applies to everything. So we end up with a mall. You know, we end up with making decisions about our lives that are fast, cheap, and easy. We want our music like that, we want our entertainment like that, when in fact, the things that give you the most pleasure are the things that that take time, like getting to know somebody. You know, like watching a sunset. Doesn't happen in a minute. It happens over a period of time. And you miss, you kind of miss living your life. And that's what's happened. And I think we all kind of long to go back to that place where we really felt connected to a rhythm of nature that helped us sort of along in our lives and helped us understand what it is to grow old, to be in our youth, to just not gear everything towards everyone who's between 20 and 50. So I have a big master plan for part of my economic stimulus.
You can't use the word stimulus.
I can't?
No. It's an economic boost, you can say that.
Okay. An economic boost, because this is how it works. That if you, and I want to know what you think about this. I mean, really, really think about this, because I'm just trying to envision how we're going to get where we need to go. And I think if we don't start at our last truly democratic institution, the public schools, if we don't begin in kindergarten, we're going to leave people out. So we have to begin in that place so that we can touch every single child. So every single child. And we feed them a free school breakfast, lunch, and afternoon snack. Okay. So that means their parents don't need to pack them a lunch or buy the food or think about that. That gives them some money back. And then you put in a criteria in the school for the buying of all the food. So you want to buy from the local sustainable people that take care of the farm workers and to offer the school the food that is seasonally ripe. And you create an affordable menu for the school that's nutritious and delicious. Okay? And that gives money to all the local people who, and in fact, it encourages people to grow sustainably. And that's all they need, is encouragement. They need to be paid the real cost of food. They cannot, as Carlo said at the beginning, or maybe it was Carlo, or maybe it was Peter, or maybe it was Raj, but they said that unless you really pay people a living wage to produce this food, that they won't be able to send their own children to the university. And we want them to be able to do that. They need to be paid for their work. And when I go out in the garden, I realize I can't do that work. I can cook the food, but I can't pick it. I can barely take care of my own tiny little garden. It's really hard to do that work. And we have to really treasure the people who do that. And I think that that's sort of the economy of Chez Panisse, or has been, that we have paid the price of food, and it has encouraged people to support us. And it has allowed us to pay 119 people who work for us. Now, the little end of this, the boosting plan, is that the kids grow up understanding the values of sustainability and of nourishment and of communication. And I think that's the kind of essential education that we all need to live on this planet. So that's it. What do you think?
Well, I'm all in favor. But I feel like in order to kind of eke out the reality here, or I want to play a little bit of a devil's advocate with you, Alice. And this is not reflecting my skepticism, because you have a convert here. I just want to get your thinking on a couple of questions that immediately come to my mind, and then you can ask me about my thinking about the questions as well. Question number one that comes to my mind has to do with cost. Now, you've alluded to a mindset that says fast, cheap, and easy is the way we are trained, unfortunately, to think about food and many other things in life. And it has great costs to us as people, as inhabitants of the planet, and so forth. But as a very practical matter, and I hate to bring us down to such mundane realities, but we are facing a budget deficit. The state is in deep, deep distress. School budgets are being cut. Teachers are being laid off. If Congress over the next couple of weeks does not come up with a budget deficit plan to cut even $1.2 trillion out of the budget, then there will be automatic cuts of $1.5 trillion, which will directly affect not only school funding, Title I funding, but also the school lunch program, also Head Start, also countless programs that deal with the well-being and the nurturance of young children. So my question for you is this. How do you justify all of this in light of the economic and political environment we are in?
Well, that was the question I was going to ask you.
Well, I'm glad I beat you to it.
You did.
I mean, but I'll give you my views, but I'm genuinely...
Okay, well, I never would have thought it was possible had there not been a bank bailout. That's $500 billion. Okay.
More than that.
More than that. Way more than that. But just for a starter, we don't need $500 billion to do this. Half of that. I never would have thought about that. I was thinking of when President Kennedy understood the physical fitness crisis of the 60s. And he told the country that we needed a core curriculum in the schools that trained children from a very early age about physical fitness, and that he wanted everybody to build that system and make it happen. And so we spent money, not government money, but state money to build tracks and engage the whole school in incorporating physical fitness into the curriculum. That's how that happened. Because he used all of his powers as president to do that. And he convinced everybody in every department there of the government to be a cheerleader for it. And when you see the kind of media of that, and you see what happened during the WPA and the way that the message was delivered, people came forth and participated and made that happen, and we can do this. Now, that's the question I really want to ask you. Will we have a president who understands that we're going to pay up front around health? I mean, out back, if we don't pay up front.
Well, Michelle Obama she has a garden. They're growing their own vegetables. Obviously, you got to them at some level. But as a practical matter, I think that here's what I would suggest. I think that what you were saying, translated into my mind, is that if you really took all of the social costs into consideration, you looked at the environmental degradation that comes from trucks and planes shipping food from all the way across the nation, around the world, if you looked at the health costs of children getting into bad habits, eating badly, eating sugary fast foods, the health costs for them now and also later on. If you looked at the learning disabilities that many of them have because they aren't eating well and they aren't eating adequately, if you look at all of the other social, environmental, and health costs together, what you are proposing is actually cheaper.
That's what I wanted to say.
But given how we don't account very well for all of these social costs in our public budgeting, B, that many of the costs are not directly, immediately, and they are not visible, and they don't happen right away, so it's easy to just slough them off. And C, because there's not evidence that you have, maybe you do have, and this is what I was going to ask you, evidence that is powerful and palpable and visible that says, look, here we have 15,000 children. That's my calculation. You said it was 1,000 15 years ago, so I'm assuming approximately 15,000. You see how quickly I did that math?
Yes.
You have 15,000 children who have gone through this education, and we have a control group because we know that there are at least 15,000 children we can identify who have not. And look at what has happened to them in terms of their health, their physical fitness. Look at what has happened to the environment in terms of local farmers versus all of the other costs. Then look at what has happened to X, Y, and Z. And because of that, you can actually make a case that it is cheaper to do it the way you're talking about than the way we're doing it now. But you've got to have the evidence. You've got to be able to summon the evidence. Do you have it, Alice?
Well, the University of California came and did a study in the public health department, and they verified that children who eat more vegetables in this project and know more about them than kids who don't have this program. Now, I mean, there are many studies that have been done on projects like this around the country, around the world. There's lots of validation for it. But when I just have to tell a little anecdote, because it really, when you go into the Edible Schoolyard at King's School, and you're all invited to come in, but when you go into the school, you just think it's as right as rain. There's nothing unusual about this. This isn't, odd because, oddly, it's like this because it's in Berkeley. It's not that. And we built other edible schoolyards in strategic places around the country, like in New Orleans and in New York and North Carolina and way in upstate New York. And the same thing happens, that when you show the children that you care about them and you bring them into this natural world, they kind of fall in love with the foods that are really good for them. And when they're empowered in a kitchen to grow, to cook their own, they have so much pride to offer it to their classmates. And it's something amazing. You know, we talk about kale and as something just unimaginable to feed children. Well, within 6 weeks, there they all are. They're doing that. And they're not doing it because you've asked them to do it. They're doing it because they want to do it. They like it. And there were a couple of kids that I met in the schoolyard. I was doing some interview in the after school, and there were two kids from high school that came by, and I just was a little afraid of what they might say to the interviewer. And in fact, they just, it's as if I told them what to say. I mean, it was so fantastic. We just came back to see how the garden was going, you know, see what was growing. And I said, well, aren't you planting a garden, you know, in the high school in Berkeley High? And they said, yes, we're thinking about a garden there, but we have gardens at home. And we're growing food at home. And what could be a better validation for it?
Now, Nikki, are we about ready for questions? Yes.
I think we need
are.
To hear from everybody else.
Okay. And so your questions, we could go on. I mean, I'm just beginning to get started with questions for you, Alice. But I want to, I think we should get your questions and both of us can respond to them. Nikki, what's the best way of doing this? Should we just call on people?
I repeat the question out loud into the mic so that everyone watching can hear.
Good.
So I'm just going to move this.
You're taking the food away.
Now I have to just point out that today we got an apple from the farmer that we're most involved with at Chez Panisse, Bob Kennard's farm, which is about an hour away up in Sonoma. And we've never gotten this little brown russet from him before. And I just think this is just such a thrill for me to experience the beauty of all of these fruits and vegetables. This is, it's kind of a thrill to me. They look like little jewels. And it's kind of one of the real pleasures of my life to go to the farmer's market every weekend and to see what's there. It's like a real meaningful moment in my week.
Thank you both. This was fantastic. And I'll make some summary comments before we get to the question and answer period. So one of the things that struck me listening is that I keep talking about the Black Panthers, but I'm going to talk about them again because they were one of my heroes. They had programs that were for survival. That's what they called them, Black Panther Party programs for survival. And one of those programs was the free breakfast program, because they knew how important it was for children to be well fed if they were going to perform. And since then, we now feed children in the morning. We have free, quote unquote, someone pays for it. But there is a breakfast program for children. And Alice isn't talking about anything different than that. Communities have already identified that they want their children to be fed. This is just an effort to actually make that happen. And I wanted to talk about pleasure, because one of the things that was mentioned up here was how you don't scold a child for what they're not eating right. You try to encourage them to eat things that feel good, that taste good. And that's an asset-based way of thinking. And any of the nonprofit types out there know about asset-based thinking versus deficit-based thinking, and we write about it in our grant proposals all the time. But that's actually how you approach people and communities, is with an asset-based way of thinking. And when it comes to pleasure, it also occurred to me that we use pleasure to heal. Pleasure can heal. We approach gardens at People's Grocery in a way that brings people together and allows them many times to process grief. Because pleasure sometimes is a privileged experience. And if you aren't reminded that pleasure is actually your access to experiencing yourself as a whole human being, that can be lost, and you can be lost in grief and in stress. And getting lost in grief and stress is such a, it's a devastating experience for folk. And so if pleasure can bring you back to yourself, it is urgent. It's not an option. And it's also a way to remember what it's like to listen to your grandmother and listen to your mother and receive teachings. What Alice talked about when it came to community building. I learned some of my deepest lessons from my Nana when we were making lemon squares together in the kitchen, because it takes a minute to make lemon squares if you make them the right way. And when we cook, when we actually take the time that it takes to cook, so much happens in that kitchen. Because there will be long periods of silence, and then you find yourself telling your parents stuff that you really wouldn't have said otherwise, just because you're there. So I wanted to reemphasize the urgency of this. Pleasure and food is access to your family. It's access to your history. It's access to your culture, and it's an access to healing. And for communities of color, especially, it's urgent. So now, first question. Well, I wanted, lastly, I guess, to speak about justifying the expense, since this is expensive.
Please.
When I found out that prisons were built at times based on the literacy rates of third graders, that felt a bit backward to me. Because you would think that then you would invest more deeply in the third graders that can't read, as opposed to building them a prison, because now when they're out in 18 and robbing things, we need a place to cage them. That's expensive, to build a way to cage that third grader that can't read, as opposed to potentially putting a garden on their campus so that they can read. I just wanted to throw that in there. Questions now, a couple of questions from the students. And format-wise, we take two questions at a time so that the most voices get in the room, and I'll repeat them. We've got one, and anybody over here? No, okay. And are you a student back there? Yes, okay, go ahead. So the question is about building the Edible Schoolyard at MLK, and how did you work with government contracts in that process? And then, second question back there. So the Edible Schoolyard has the potential to teach math, science, et cetera, but it also has the potential to grow future public advocates. And is there any direct programming that the Edible Schoolyard does to encourage this?
Well, there's a lot of indirect programming. When you go out and grow something yourself, you have pleasure in doing that, you are identifying with the farmer, and you're dignifying and the work of that person, and I think we're going to grow. I mean, really, in a beautiful way, bring a whole generation of kids into farming, into taking care of the land for all of us. And I think it just happens naturally. We have degraded the farmer, and his work has always been thought of as just painful. And you have to go out there and just ma and pa out there on that farm and doing it all by yourself. And we have to show that there is a culture of farming that can be cooperative, and that it's an intellectual. I mean, that's another idea of Carlo Petrini's when he talked about farmers being the intellectuals of the land and the fishermen being the intellectuals of the sea. I mean, it's just such an incredible idea, and that just happens naturally. Now, the other question that you asked about all the paperwork and all from the government, and how did Ann Cooper manage that? It's because it was Ann Cooper. And let me tell you, She did the work of 10. And she pushed that to make it happen. But she didn't arrive at the real integration of a cafeteria in bringing it into academia. We can't have that kind of catering happen out there in, you know, disconnected with academia. We need to bring it in, to curate it, if you will. Bring it into all the subjects. That's the core of the university. That's where it needs to be. I mean, we all eat. We all eat, if we're lucky, every day. And every time we eat, it's a political decision about supporting people who have this shared values or by really destroying communities around the world. So we have that decision in front of us every single day at every single meal. And I think that it really needs to be understood at that level. You need to do that here at the University of California. You really need to question where the food comes from. It's not how it's cooked. It is the provenance of that food. Where do they buy it? Is it from China? Is it from somebody you know? And ask that question. Because when we started asking those questions at Yale, when we started the Yale Sustainable Food Project, we were pretty shocked by where the food came from. And fortunately, the university decided to take on that project and help to pay for a Yale farm to start. And now they grow 300 varieties of fruits and vegetables. They have 200 student volunteers who work in the garden. And they have learned about all the local farms. They come early and do gleaning at these farms. And so they get to know the farmers. And now what they're doing is gathering all the tomatoes that are locally grown and bringing them to a canning factory that's right near the university. They're canning everything and they're selling it to the university cafeteria. So it's a beautiful sort of closed system that happened because the students wanted it to happen. That's why it happened.
We want to get to a lot of your questions, but let me just, there was a relationship between the two questions that were just asked that I can't resist responding to. One was about government contractors, the other was about advocacy. And let me just say that there will be a point, Alice, where the edible schoolyard movement, if you want to call it that, becomes large enough that it becomes, in a sense, a threat to government contractors, to the agribusiness, to all of the purveyors, advertisers, marketers of junk food. And that's where the advocacy training and organizing comes in. Because unless it is really a movement, and unless it has the organization and heft and mobilization of a movement, there's almost no way of counteracting those very brute economic forces. It's one thing, Alice, for us to talk about edible schoolyards in Berkeley, California, and in other so-called enlightened precincts. But it is very, very difficult and very different to talk about it in some other places. I'm interested in scaling this up, Alice. I mean, scalability is really important here. And so most of the questions I would have for you, if we had more time, would be about scaling it up. How do you actually do the politics and economics?
All right, a couple more questions. So one right there in the corner, and then no one on this side is asking questions. And then go ahead. Yes, you did it. Wait, but first, Alex, yep.
Thank you.
So the question is that the way schools work now is that their food is cheap because it's surplus food. And if they actually were more intentional about the food they were buying, it would be way more expensive. And so what pressures do we need to put on the system that forces schools to buy cheap surplus food? And then, go ahead. So what is it going to take for us to see the intersectional nature of the problem? That food is a commentary on labor, on economics, on politics, on race. And is it a visionary leader? Is it something else? What's it going to take?
Well, first of all, surplus food is not free. We provide agribusiness with huge subsidies every year. And not only do we subsidize to the tune of, the last time I looked, it was more than $60 billion a year. I mean, there would be no free surplus food without all of those subsidies. Secondly, we also have tariffs and quotas against the importation of a lot of food from abroad. A lot of that food would otherwise find our way even more cheaply to our tables, and also presumably provide some income to a lot of farmers around the world who now cannot possibly sell to us, either because we have subsidized our food or because we have blocked their exports to us. So the economics of agriculture are very germane and very central to all of this. If we didn't have those subsidies and if we didn't have those trade barriers, we could do a lot of this much more cheaply. And indeed, I think part of the next point, that is visionary leadership, is to connect the dots for people, to show people that not only is this cheaper, but it is also an introduction to a whole way of viewing ecology, the environment, health, many of the other problems we have in this country, and solving them. But it's not only visionary leadership, connecting the dots. It's not only public education. It's also having some very clever political strategies, because visionary leaders, litter the universe. You have to have political strategists who are capable of turning visionary ideas into genuine political on-the-ground movements. And there is an interesting connection to all of this, and all of this discussion to what's beginning to happen around the country right now.
Well, I would love to answer that, because I think it's immoral to feed children in school food that's not good for them. And when you have the possibility of 1 in 2 kids going to grow up and have diabetes, you have to really think about that. You have to really, really think about that. I wouldn't go another day feeding kids food that's not good for them. And it takes a precedent to talk to us about that. And we need to go to that place. We need to go to that place right now. But I think what's happening, and it's happening in this class, is that you're hearing all of these ideas, and they're all fitting together like a patchwork quilt. And pretty soon we're going to be able to see this quilt. And it's very important that we build models where that people can walk into. And I think that's proved to me, the Edible Schoolyard proved to me that it could be a gathering place for people to have this conversation. And what happened at the 40th birthday of the restaurant just this last August was that we invited the governor, Brown, to come to an event that we had here at the university at the Art Museum. And there were big banners that were hanging off the balconies, and it said, free speech, free lunch, in that room. And we asked him to comment on that, and he did. And then right after it, I said, can we start a governor's task force on edible education in California? And he didn't know what to say for a moment, and so we had a little meeting with his Secretary of Agriculture and her deputy and the past superintendent of schools in the state of California, Delaine Easton, and a few other activists at the table at Chez Panisse. And we thought, wouldn't it be great if we could build schools all in California, all around the state, in high schools, grammar schools, middle schools, and if we could show the whole vision, that we would find philanthropists to fund it, that we would find the people who have been working on these ideas for so long, either in terms of curriculum, in terms of gardens, in terms of rethinking school lunch, and that we could build these places of demonstration, and how incredible that could be. And he said yes. And we're gonna do this. We're gonna do this. So you're gonna have to help us.
And
we need everybody's volunteering.
Everybody.
Shelling
peas, exactly. And just to comment on the intersection question and make explicit what Bob implied at the end there. So Occupy, right? There's a, general strike in Occupy Oakland tomorrow. But I wanted to talk about the phenomenon that's happening, because I heard a rumor that downtown Oakland has the highest concentration of nonprofits in the country, right? Because that's just what we do in Oakland. We start nonprofits. But it's because Oakland has been this place of deep radicalism for such a long time. And whenever something happens, we are the first ones getting arrested. We're the first ones in the news getting hit over the head by cops. We're the first ones fighting the cops. We're the first ones who do a lot of stuff. And what's happened with our Occupy is that we've gotten so forceful and so clear so quickly that all of these entities, labor is talking to the food movement in a way that it hasn't really communicated with before. Education is talking to business in a way that it hasn't before. Last Wednesday, there were 2,000 or 3,000 people sitting in circles in the plaza in Oakland discussing what to do this week and how to actually have a truly intersectional movement. I've never seen anything like this before. And so not to say that Occupy is the salvation, but what Occupy did, whenever you try to do something intersectional, people usually don't get it. It's hard for massive groups of people to understand that kind of complexity, which is why the media tries to break everything down simply. But what Occupy has done is create something so complex that all people keep asking is, what are they trying to do? Like, why are they occupying? The message isn't clear, I don't get it. But people keep asking the question repeatedly, and every time they get a different answer, and the fifth or sixth time they get a different answer, it starts to click that it's actually about all of it. So we need more things like that, where people consistently ask the same question and get different answers and start to understand that it's about all of it. Couple more questions. One right there, and one over there. Yes, good job, section on the right. All right, go ahead. So, Bobby mentioned earlier.
I think that's yours for sure.
That government subsidies, the way they work now, is a bit problematic. So what is it going to take for those to shift? And then last question over there. So the question is, you had a principal that was great from the beginning, but let's say the administration isn't so friendly. How could you work from the bottom up and the top down? What are the different strategies in addition to just starting with the principal to having an edible schoolyard?
Let me just answer the first question, then I'll turn it over to Alice for the second question. In terms of agricultural subsidies, there is an opportunity that will be opening up over the next couple of months that we haven't had before, because the super committee, as it's called, of Congress is going to be reporting by Thanksgiving or shortly after Thanksgiving with a plan to cut $1.2 trillion from the federal budget over the next 10 years, beginning in 2013. If they don't come up with a plan that Congress then votes for, there will be cuts of $1.5 trillion over the next 10 years. Now, let me enable you to see inside what's really going on. What's inside of what's really going on is Democrats would like to push Republicans to hold on to as much as possible by holding defense and the defense budget as hostage. Because if they don't reach agreement, a big chunk of the defense budget automatically disappears. The problem is, not only does defense budget automatically disappear, but a big part of what's called the domestic discretionary budget also disappears, and that has a lot of things for kids, and for nutrition, and for child care, and for education, and a lot of things we believe in. That also disappears. So that's part of the drama. Nobody knows where to get the money if you're going to avoid this kind of showdown. And also if you're going to avoid cutting Medicare and Medicaid, which nobody really wants to do. So where is the money going to come from? Well, one way of getting the money is to end corporate welfare. That is, subsidies. Subsidies that are going to big agribusinesses, that are going to big pharmaceutical companies, subsidies that are going to Wall Street, subsidies that are going to major industries that total, according to the very conservative American Enterprise Institute, about $99 to $120 billion a year. That would be enough. Agricultural subsidies are a big chunk of that. There's a possibility here of getting the left and the right together to overcome the farmers' lobbies, big agriculture. It's not going to be easy, but there will be an attempt. And watch very, very clearly. If we had a true movement in this country of a sort that Alice is talking about, that movement would be organizing at this time and would use this opportunity to make sure that a lot of those savings went into edible education.
Well, indeed. But I think the thing that we really have on our side is a vision of how we can educate kids that is incredibly hopeful. Everything is sort of, it's what's wrong. Everybody's talking about what's wrong. And what we're doing is we're talking about what's right and what's possible. And I think there are a lot of people who desperately need that idea to be part of their lives. And that's, I call this, you know, at the restaurant and what we're doing, a delicious revolution. Because this is not hard to do. You are not denying yourself. You are buying the best tasting food and paying the farmer a real salary. It's like somebody accused me of being a farmer's market philanthropist. And I thought, well, how beautiful is that? How I love that. And that's what I do. Every time I think about, you know, how do I want to spend my money? I want to spend it there. That's where I want to spend my money. And I feel really good about doing it. So this is, I think that's the place we need to go to. And I think it's going to bring people right and left and center to thinking about these values. I mean, who could not want a good education for his kid? Who could not want schools to be kept up and children to be fed? I mean, it just all goes together. And you were asking up there about ways to get into places where it's difficult, there isn't an enlightened principal. Well, I'll tell you, there are a lot of enlightened children. And they are able to speak about this from 6 years old. I mean, they're incredible what they're able to, what they know about what's happening in the world. And they can do something remarkable. I have one little quick story before you leave about a 13-year-old kid in Connecticut. He decided, his name is Sam Levin, and he decided that he wanted to make a garden in the school. And he raised money from the parents of the kids. He got $30,000 to clear the land, to bring in what he needed, and he got all of his schoolmates to volunteer the time to build that garden. 2 years later, when he was 15, he came out here for Slow Food Nation that happened in San Francisco. And he spoke to a whole group of people that were at an eat-in in Dolores Park in San Francisco. He was so compelling that he was invited to speak at the International Convention of Slow Food to 8,000 people from 151 countries. He got up on the podium, and he was sitting next to me, and he had a speech that was about this thick. And I was just terrified for him to go up and to read this speech. Well, he got up there, he never looked at the speech. He spoke from his heart, and he spoke to ministers of agriculture and all of these people. And he got a standing ovation for this. And he's part of the Slow Food film that was made. Okay, another year passes, and he's providing food for the cafeteria in his high school. This is a public high school in Connecticut. Sorry, it's in Massachusetts, Great Barrington, Massachusetts. He gets that food into the cafeteria, and then he becomes a senior in high school. And he asks the question, why don't any of my classmates want to go to school anymore? Why don't they like school? And he proposed to the principal of the school to teach a course, to teach a group of high school kids in an entirely different way. If they managed to learn all that they needed to learn as seniors. So he gets a whole group, he's able to do this. He gets a whole group of kids to participate in this experiment. And it's all of the best practices of education reform that we know about. Mentorship, connecting with the bigger community out there, getting kids hands-on in the garden, all of those ideas, having little groups of kids brainstorm together in their math classes. And then he made a movie about it. And there are testimonials of this kid. All the kids did wonderfully well. And you know, That's where it has to go. That's what has to happen. And we want to bring, we want kids to love to go to school. Love to go to school. Have the curiosity, have the desire, have the passion. And that's really what's going to change the world. Deeply.
Give them a hand, everyone. Change the world. Leave with that.
Okay.
And we will see you next week.